just, since people didn't have a chance to really use the facilities for a long stretch of time, so we're waiting for a few more minutes, but I think we're good. So I'm Senator Ballant, and I represent Wyndham County. I live in Brattleboro, and this is my second term in the Senate. I serve on the Economic Development Committee and the Education Committee. And I am also the Majority Leader, as I mentioned this morning. So we're just gonna start with introductions, and we'll go from there.
My name's Amber Clutt. I'm the Communications Director at Vermont Natural Resources Council, VNRC. And I also work with Lauren at Vermont Conservation Voters, DC.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Ramos. I'm a lobbyist. So that can be scary for people.
She pauses a little bit.
Lobbyist, because some people are like, oh, you're a lobbyist?
Is that what you look like? I have my cootie spray right here. Oh,
I know, baby. So I'm a lobbyist. Have been a staffer before for folks you may know, like Howard Dean and Peter Welch. I lobbied right after law school for something you may be familiar with called civil unions. I work for a group called Nicrasin Group. We are sort of the white hat lobbying firm. So if you're familiar with spy versus spy, MAD, white hat. So, so we have a social filter. Our firm does a lot of energy work. In particular, we represent groups like Energy Independent Vermont, REV, VEIC, Climate Action Network. So we do a lot of energy work, and I'm the lead on most of those. So I'm gonna start us out with, so first of all, thanks for coming. We realize it is Saturday and you're here, and it's a big effort sometimes to take away from your family and your friends and sleeping in, maybe, coffee. I know where I would be right now, but. So I'm gonna get started with, who has spent time advocating, maybe like at the State House? Who's been to the State House? Okay, great. And who knows one of their legislators? Excellent work, okay. And who's on here on an energy committee? Okay, wow. So exciting. So we are engaged citizens who are, so we will do a little more advanced work. I won't start with the three branches of government unless someone needs me to. Okay. So as an advocate lobbyist, even though we do work with the executive branch, never judicial branch, there is a lobbying and advocacy that happens there, but that is really not for this conversation. Our firm in particular, and what we do, we work a lot on campaigns for change. So examples include stuff that we have worked on, include gun safety, marijuana reform, carbon pricing. And the reason that I bring up these campaigns for change is because advocacy around change is very different than advocacy around things like stopping change or smaller things that aren't hard to do. Off the work that we're trying to do around energy and climate, that's hard to do, and it takes it is not as simple as introducing a bill and it going through both chambers and you got a bill on the governor's desk in 1 year. It is work that happens. Our firm did Death with Dignity. It took them 14 years. So, and it takes
take
a long view. And so for a lot of things that are hard to do and what you're building support for, it takes. You can't, if you think of success as passing a bill in a short period of time, then you should leave, because that's not how this works, right? And I think I was probably around 32 when I figured that out, and it was super sad. Oh, I'm gonna be really old when I get the stuff I want. So, it's not true. So I work a lot with environmental groups and conservation groups and folks who care about energy, and I'm sort of the lobbyist. I mean, often I work like, so Lauren, who is Lauren Hurl, if you works for VNRC and BCB, or BCB, I work a lot with Lauren and other lobbyists that work on energy and environmental issues, and so that means often I'm doing strategic work. So thinking the 2, 4, 6 years out, this is important. I can't be successful at my work if we don't have people in the communities doing the work in the communities. And what I mean by that the strategies, when we're doing incremental change, and I know, you know, sometimes I always say, like, really passing a bill is just a math problem, right? You're just getting 76, right? Just getting 76 in the House and 16 in the Senate, especially on issues like ours, because they're tough, and you're not getting 120 votes in the House, right? You're getting maybe 80. So sometimes we can focus too much on those six votes that you need to get to, you know, 76, 77. But the reality, without the work by the advocates in the community, we can't even get to 76, right? And the more you all are doing, the more that work is happening in the more you're doing the relationship building and the engaging in your towns with your legislators, and letting us know how that's happening, that means we can continue to change our strategy and maneuver with that information. And then as we get that information, it goes back to you all. And so it's this feedback loop that's I can't be successful unless you all are successful. We're not, you know, like, as a strategist, I can't provide good information if the work isn't happening in the district. And so it's so the reality is we can't make change at the State House on hard policies without you, right? We can throw as much money as we want at it. And there are some things that are not exactly like that. You know, I'm inside the building, you guys are outside the building. We can do a few, you can do a thing or two on the inside the building lobbying effort, but it's usually very small and it's quick. The stuff that we're talking about is not an inside the building issue. It is a outside the building issue that pressure has to come from the outside that forces legislators to act. As you all know, and I missed part of the, So climate is tricky in our State House right now, especially carbon pricing. If people have a little fear about that, this feels very familiar to me. It was when I worked on gun safety issues, which is, even though legislators know Vermonters care about it, they understand the problem and they care about it too, there is fear around action. Partially, one is because they're not exactly sure what to do, and they don't know what the consequences are, right? And so part of what we like to say is that we're trying to, we're not moving people from no to yes, moving people from no to neutral, right? And if you can think of it that way, like, oh, I'm not just trying to get them to agree with me, I'm just trying to, for some legislators, you're just trying to get them to be not afraid of having the conversation. And so being able to think about it in these pieces and understanding these are relationships that will take a long time, and that you have to, they're baby steps, is helpful in our long game strategy. So Amber and Senator Ballin are gonna talk to you about the sort of how that happens and how to be effective advocates, particularly from a, I'll let you guys work yourselves. So anyway, any questions from that perspective? Okay.
Thanks, Rebecca. One of the things I was thinking about as I prepared for this is thinking about the ways in which people have lobbied me that have not been successful. And right, because those are the things I remember. I don't really remember the successful times, the successful conversations I had. So I just wanted to start with a little story. So I was deeply involved in trying to figure out how we were going to make some compromise around marijuana legislation, and I represent Windham County, and we are very supportive of marijuana legislation. We are very supportive of issues that we're talking about today around energy, right? So for me, it's a comfortable place to be on those issues, and it is for many other legislators that represent much more politically diverse districts. So I just want to frame that as well. But so I opened up my email, and there's just like a slew of emails during the session, and opened up the email, and the first line was, "Dear Senator Pothead." That was that was the greeting. Okay,
so that was good.
I thought it might have been. And so I read, you know, you can always tell at a glance, it's all caps, and there's like 8 exclamation points, and what the hell are you people doing, and, you know, on and on and on and on. And in those moments, it's really hard, because what you want to do is you want to just hit delete. This constituent is not engaging with me in a respectful manner, but it's also just not productive, right? Let's talk about what your real issues are with the bill as it appears. And so I was sitting with some other folks, some of whom were in the legislature at that time and some of whom had gone on to do other things. And so they saw me writing back and they said, why are you writing back? Like, he's not gonna listen to you. I was like, well, I wanna give him some feedback on how to lobby and advocate. He feels strongly about this. I said, I'm not gonna write a lot back, but I'm gonna say, just a little FYI, if you start with Senator Pothead, I'm not really interested in engaging with you, but I'm gonna give you a few more minutes because I can tell that you care and you're in my district. And it was really interesting. So we had this back and forth, and he did.
So how did he take it when you said the advice?
He wrote back within 10 minutes and he said, you're right, I'm sorry. I'm just very upset about this issue. Now, sometimes you don't get the, you're right, I'm sorry. You don't. But in that instance, it did work, and there are several other times in which that has worked. Mm-hmm. So I want to just remind all of us here that we do have a citizen legislature. And many of the people who are in office don't actually see themselves as powerful. Okay? Some do. Some do, if you're a chair of a powerful committee, you know, they may. But most people just feel like this is this other job that I do in addition to the job that I have back. So it can be very startling when people see you in this role of malevolent overlord, okay? Okay, so I just want to frame it that way because, okay, so the other day, another little story, I was talking with a group locally that's very much involved in climate action work, and they wanted to talk to me about what was effective. And I said, well, it doesn't tend to be effective when we get a slew of just identical emails from an organization. Right, so it pops up on you get an email from your organization, they say, please send an email to your legislators. And I understand, we don't have that much time, so it feels like I'm doing something. But what's hard for us is, we get lots and lots and lots of those emails that are identical. And we're thinking to ourselves, well, how much does this person really care? Because they didn't take the time to write me a thoughtful note. They're taking my time to read it, but it's all identical. So I just wanna I think it goes both ways in terms of the volume, okay? So this woman in the group said, well, don't you just have a staff member who sorts through all of those? I said, no, we don't have any staff, right? So we do, especially in the Senate, and I see Senator McDonald over there, we have to do triage all the time. So I open my email at the end of the day because we can't have our laptops on the Senate floor. So for hours and hours a day, we can't be in touch with anybody about anything unless it's on a pink slip piece of paper running in and out. Okay, so we get to the end of the day, we open up the email, and there's just a slew of these, what I call robo emails. And then it's not that I don't care about them, it's just I gotta figure out, how am I gonna wade through this, because I got all this work to do in the evening. So basically, I just do a quick tally, but I only read the ones that are individual emails. So I just want you to think about that in terms of being effective, that as a senator, I feel like my time is really valuable. As a person, my time is really valuable. And so the same thing has to hold on the side of advocacy. If you truly care about it, then take the time to call or to write a personal email. And so I know it's a lot of work, but I certainly have talked to many of the people in my chamber who feel like I can't even look at those robo emails anymore. I just can't. So that's something to keep in mind. The other thing is, in emails and in phone calls as well, it's really important not to be histrionic. Even when we care so deeply about issues. I can be histrionic. I have it in me, right? But I have to think about, again, impact and effectiveness. That if I start from up here on an issue of, if I think about trash hauling in my county, if I start from up here.
Really trash hauling?
I'm saying that's where I'm going, Rebecca. Stay with me, baby. Okay? There was a section where there were a lot of my trash haulers were calling me, and there was this fevered pitch, okay? And it was important to them. Absolutely, it was important to them. But at the same time, I'm trying to find more beds for opioid treatment, and we have thousands of Vermonters needing treatment and who are dying, right? right? So if we put them all at the same level all the time, then what happens is nothing matters anymore, right? So to really be thinking about, how am I gonna engage with this senator about what's happening in their district, right? So as you know, I'm sure you've heard it, stories matter. Having somebody call and say, let me tell you how this impacts me directly. This is how impacting my neighborhood, this is how impacting my family who's lived here for many, many generations. But if you start from, you are a horrible person that doesn't understand that the earth is going to, you know, explode in the next few years, you may really feel that way. And the person you're talking to might actually feel that way. But you have shut out a much deeper conversation that will allow them to go into committee and make a pitch for you and represent your interest there. So obviously, name calling generally doesn't work generally. Another thing that I found.
That happened so often that it had to be on the list.
You know, it's gotten worse since Trump took office.
Mm-hmm.
It really has, and I just need you to know this, that we in this small state are still experiencing it. It's not at the same level in terms of volume, but I've gotten a lot nastier emails, and not just specifically to me. I mean, they'll send them to all the senators, you know. And so so we have the sense of that we're all very loving and genteel, and not so much, okay? And there has been a sense of this regime has allowed a certain level of discourse that hasn't been allowed in the past. So I think, just to be aware of that. One of the things that I think advocacy groups fall into a little bit of a trap is they'll come in and they'll testify in committee and they will be very civil and engaged and working towards solutions, and then they'll leave the committee room and then someone from their organization will get on social media and then just trash the people they were just testifying in front of, right? Whether it is the chair of the committee or, you know, their local senator. Because they're angry, because they don't feel like they're moving on it. But what happens is you've lost all your credibility and your organization has. So even if you have really good points, which you often do, those senators, those House members are people. And they see themselves getting trashed on social media and they feel like, well, I'm not going to engage with that group anymore because I thought we had an understanding.
Or
right?
That we don't trust you.
We don't trust
right,
you.
Right.
That you say one thing in committee and then you go and do another thing on social media. So just to be aware of that. And that's hard because we all are empowered, right? So you who are on committees with people or organizations, it's very hard, but you have to try to have all your people on the same page about strategy and not having people go rogue.
Right. So I think that gets to one of the things because our state is small, your integrity and your trust as an advocate are very important. If your legislator in your district or your legislators, they don't trust you, your information you give them is too biased, or they're not gonna be able to hear you fully and they're not gonna be able to represent you fully. So it is the trust, that is, lobbyists talking about trust being a priority. I just want you to note that.
Another couple things, in the same vein of don't name call, don't be snarky. Like, you don't like to get a snarky email. Legislators don't like to get it either. Again, it's not moving the conversation forward. So I would encourage all of you, if you're writing a personal email on behalf of yourself or an advocacy, write it, have somebody else look at it, put it away for a couple hours. That's what I do when I'm trying to write back to a constituent and I'm just like, I gotta channel my best self, right? Not my most snarky self. And the other piece of that is, on the macro, you have to know your audience, right? So, true story, as an economic development last session, and there was a group that came in of younger people, millennials who had done a particular program at UVM, and they came to the Economic Development Committee to make a pitch for how younger people in the state needed to have more specific tax breaks to get them to stay around, whether it's loan forgiveness or down payment assistance, all these things. But so they didn't take a moment to look around the room and realize, everyone in that room was over 65, except for me. And as part of their pitch, they totally dissed all the programs geared towards the older people in Vermont. And so I could just watch all the eyebrows like shooting up around the room. And it was like, and done. Everybody was like, and done. So I followed them out into the hallway. I said, just a little FYI in general, like if you want to bring people to your cause, don't insult them to their faces, and don't make them feel like they're somehow doing something wrong by just existing. And so, you know, so really think about audience all the time, because you don't want to just win the little victory, right? You want to actually change legislation or change policy. So those were the big things that I wanted to say. And so do we want to take questions before you go, or do you want to wrap at the end? How do you want to do it?
I'll go ahead and follow up, and then
okay.
We can open up for questions unless there are
yeah.
burning questions right now for folks.
Okay. Is it a burning question?
Yes.
Those 65-year-olds presumably all have kids, or a lot of them do.
Yes, absolutely. But in that moment,
right.
I could see it on their faces, right? But absolutely. And then you have to tie it back to, I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
You've got to tie it back to the story about what their children's experiences are and their grandchildren. Excellent. Yes.
Thanks. If you have one more on your list, that's bad breath.
Oh, thank you. I forgot. Bad breath. And I meant to bring my Altoids. Okay. So, and seriously, like, if you are sending people to meet one-on-one with a legislator, and it's happened to me before, they want to corral you into some private corner, right? They want to have the little face, just a moment of your time, you know? And when they breathe on you with really bad breath, like, I don't care what you're talking about, I have stopped listening. So what I do is I carry my Altoids with me. It's like, just a simple little thing that you can do. Always have a Tic Tac right at the ready.
So. I always have gum in my bag. So
see? Gum, Tic Tac, Altoid.
Yeah.
I forgot that was my last point. Bad breath. Yeah.
So again, my name's Amber. I'm the communications director at Vermont Natural Resources Council, and I'm relatively new to the position. I've only been there about 6 months, and prior to that, I was serving I was in grad school and also a communications consultant working with major foundations across the country and other environmental nonprofits on a wide range of issues, including wilderness and wildlife, marriage equality, Native Indigenous rights, sustainable agriculture, bike, walk, transit, you name it, anything that was kind of in that, quote, environmental space or could be conceived of as environmental was in my portfolio. So I'll talk a bit about our work at VNRC, but then I also want to share some examples of effective advocacy work that I've seen across the country. And if I can get the computer to work, I might pop up and show you a couple of pictures as well. But I do want to reiterate a little bit, actually, of what Lauren said in the larger conversation, is that it really does matter who we elect. And on the flip side of that, it matters that you, as advocates with people who care about an issue, who are passionate about something, hold those elected officials, once they are in office, accountable to the positions that they hold. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. You know, these folks are here to represent you. They are people. You can have conversations with them. And their job is to enact your values into policy, more or less. And so they need to know what you're thinking. And they don't have staff members. And oftentimes, you guys, as the advocates in your communities, have a lot of that local knowledge, have a lot of that technical expertise. And that's something that you can bring and have to offer in those conversations. And I hope you all hold that and really take that to heart. And in Vermont, you know, we do have the citizen legislature, and we care about the quality of our environment and our relationships. And so for me, when I think of communications and good communications, I don't necessarily think of it as somebody telling somebody else what to do, think, or believe. I think of great communications as a conversation, because a conversation inevitably means that you're in relationship with another mm-hmm. person and everyone else who's in that conversation. You're building trust, whether it's through one conversation at a time or knocking on someone's door and saying, hey, I care about this issue. I'm your neighbor. We have that in common. Do you care about this issue too? You have a lot of power there when you build those trusting relationships. So if you look at, I think everyone has on their chairs, these nifty little citizen advocate guides. This has a lot of the really great nitty gritty of just how do you do this work in an effective way. You'll see there's contact information for your elected officials on the back. I encourage you all to use that. But I'm happy to answer any questions about the material in here, but feel free to look through. There's citizen lobby visits, how to write a letter to the editor, how to have a meeting with an editorial board, some of the
this is great.
The helpful
statehouse lingo.
Yeah. So you can really feel like an expert when you're walking the halls of the Capitol. The other thing that I want to say is that as an organization, VNRC members and VCV staffers, we can be at the State House every day. We know that that's not always something that you guys with busy lives and families and work obligations can do. And so that's one thing that we do offer Vermonters is that ability to keep you up to date day to day about what is going on at the Capitol and how you can be involved as effective advocates. On top of that, we're a membership-based organization, and so we literally can't do this work without you. You fund our work, but then when we go in and meet with elected officials, we can say we have X number of Vermonters who support this issue and are dues-paying members of VNRC, and that's powerful as well. So I encourage you, if you guys are interested, to check out VNRC and become a member. It really does help us advocate better for our issues and shared concerns. I've got a lot of notes. Unlike these guys who are very good at talking without notes. But to that end, because we are at the Capitol every day, we're really committed to keeping you guys in the loop. And we're going to be launching some more consistent communications efforts for this upcoming session. And I'm going to try and hop up and see if I can get this computer to work real quick. Are any of you already members of VNRC or VCD? Yes, I see a couple hands. Okay, that is very exciting.
So while Amber works on this, I'll just tell some.
Yes.
Some notes too. So some of you all may have someone like Senator Ballant who's already somewhat a little bit progressive on ideas that are harder to move. So you're like, well, what am I supposed to do? I have these legislators that are already like agree with me. What else can I do? So the reality is that often when we have legislators that are not sure what to do, the peer-to-peer lobbying where you have senators talking to senators, House members talking to House members become critical. And so if you have a strong relationship with your more liberal House or Senate member, them continuing to feel like you have their back allows them to go into the building to talk to maybe some of those, when their constituents are feeling strong about something, they can go talk to those 10 people in the middle that need to be moved. And sometimes that peer-to-peer lobbying is the most effective thing. So just because like your person's already a superstar on these issues, understand that they have there's a role in the State House for them. That is not me, they may not be obvious.
So I'm not a tech guru, so I apologize that this is very, very tiny. I have no idea how to work this projector. But I'll just kind of hold it up. So
I think it's because we did this to you. This is our fault.
You have to just pull the device back.
Oh, exactly.
Okay.
Just move it towards the center.
Exactly.
Yeah. Thank you guys for your patience.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Team effort, much like lobbying and effective advocacy. So, as I was saying earlier, we do have an activist network, so that's one way that we let folks know what's going on at the State House. You can navigate to that from vnrc.org. If you're interested in becoming a member, it's just this red button here. And one thing that we'll also be doing is posting regular updates about the works with briefings. And so you've heard a lot of mention of the new carbon pricing proposal, the Essex Plan. We have information up on our website right now about that. I encourage you to check it out. And one thing that we did was a webinar on that. And so we will be doing a series of webinars throughout the legislative session on important policy initiatives and leadership skills. And so be sure to sign up for those weekly legislative bulletin updates so you don't miss out on any of those great opportunities to learn more and get even more engaged.
What's the purpose of the webinars?
So the webinars are a chance for you as advocates to dig a little deeper onto any of those policy initiatives that we were doing. And the great thing about the webinars is that we haven't yet set the content for them. And so part of what I'm excited about
sounds
being
like
here
the tax
today
plan.
Well, hopefully a little better than the tax plan. Let's be zero. But one thing that I do want to ask you guys at the end is what you want to hear about in those webinars. You know, we want to make sure, again, that this is a conversation that we're hearing from you and that we're providing you with the resources that you need to be the most effective advocates. And so one of the questions that I actually have for you at the very end of this is, what would you like to see? What do you want to know about? What skills do you want to practice and learn more about? So keep that in the back of your minds and come up with a great list for me. I'm excited to hear it. The other thing that I wanted to talk about is that we'll be doing, how many folks are on Facebook? All right. So we'll be doing some live videos every week on the VNRC and the VCB Facebook pages. Be sure to check in on those. We'll have climate-focused ones. And the way to tune into those conversations, we'll be using the hashtags both on Facebook and Twitter. And that hashtag is ActOnClimateVT. So if you're on either of those social media platforms, be sure to follow those for regular updates from the State House and from our dedicated staffers. The other great thing about that hashtag is that it's not just us using it. It's a whole coalition of organizations throughout the state of Vermont. So it's a really phenomenal way to find out what everyone is working on and how we're working together to move Vermont towards a cleaner and brighter energy future, which is, I think, pretty exciting. The other thing that I just wanted to talk about was one example from Minnesota about, we mentioned the importance of building trust. And so, again, secret conversation or secret weapon is conversations. So having those face-to-face conversations with people really matter, and they're really important. I know they're time intensive, but they really do count. And having them with people who are in your church or at your school or your next door neighbor, those are really impactful ways of connecting with people. And the example, there was a campaign in 2012 in Minnesota to pass marriage equality. And the interesting thing about this was that they rolled out the secret weapon of conversations. And what ended up happening, if you take a look at how places actually voted, so the green are, they voted against marriage equality, the yellow, they voted for it. We knew that the city, Minneapolis, typically like younger population, very progressive, was already going to vote for it. And so what they did was they rolled out this conversations plan. And so what you'll notice on this map is that these are very rural, traditionally conservative areas of Minnesota that voted in favor of this Marriage Equality Act. And the reason that that happened was because they identified advocates in each of those communities who volunteered to go have conversations with people. That's it. They didn't say, I'm not going to tell you which way to vote, but I am going to say, this is who I am, this is why I care about this issue, and I think you, this is how I'm going to vote, and I'd encourage you to think about it. And then they would come back the next week and say, did you think about it? Do you want to talk about it? Do you have any questions? What do you think now? Do you want to talk to my friend who is hoping to marry her partner of 17 years? And it's a lot harder to say no to somebody when you realize that they're your neighbor, when they're your best friend, when they're your child's best friend, when they're a member of your community. And so it ended up becoming a hugely successful campaign, obviously passed. And again, you know, it really brought the human element to that effective way of communicating. There they are again. And so to that end, you know, we at Vermont Conservation Voters also think about who's bringing that message, whether it's you, but who else in your community is influential. So for example, we're working to pass S-103, toxic chemical reform, and firefighters unfortunately are at an increased risk of cancer and illness because they're exposed to the toxic chemicals that are released from burning products in homes. So Brad, we worked with Brad Reed, he's the president of the Professional Firefighters of Vermont, to capture a short video explaining why his organization cares about this issue. And then we send it out to you guys and say, you know what, we have an opportunity right now in this upcoming legislative session to pass a bill that will protect firefighters. They protect us. We can probably return the favor. And Brad is also an incredibly nice guy. We would like him to see him be okay. This is just an example of one of those communication style that you would see from us that just says, here's how you can actually be involved. Here's how you can engage. Contact your senator. We've got a link that shows you exactly how to contact and who. And then we also want to hear from you. We want to hear your stories. If you want to send us a video, great. And so it's just an example of collecting stories to advocate and better communicate with neighbors, elected officials, and other organizations. So, all right, I think that's it.
So I think our hope was just to leave a lot of time for questions and conversation, because I'm sure that you have specific things that you want answered, and I also want to invite Senator McDonald as well to chime in if there are things that we're missing. One thing that I did want to say before we go on is that oftentimes people will say, well, you know, you're here to represent me, right? You're here to represent us, and that is absolutely true. The problem is that the us is really big, right? So I represent Brattleboro, I also represent Bellows Falls, and a huge swath of towns and people in between. So when somebody's getting really angry with me and they say, you know, why aren't you listening to me? And I say, well, I am listening to you, I'm listening deeply, and I'm also listening to that voter who called me last night from Putney and the one who called me from Westminster, and you're not actually all in agreement about what I should do. So just to always have that in the back of the mind, that if you feel like someone, a legislator, isn't telling you up front how it is that they're going to vote, and oftentimes they do know how they're gonna vote, but it's because there are conflicting narratives coming to them, and they're trying to weigh that. The other piece is that I meant to mention early on is, I know it might work for some legislators. I think for most people, threatening them and saying, we'll remember in November, or, you know, we're gonna remember how you vote. Like, of course you are, that's your job as a voter. But to imply in that, that somehow I would change my vote because you're telling me you're gonna punish me about it, like, I'm gonna vote based on the information that I have. I'm gonna vote because I have a moral compass and I'm gonna do what's right. So the implication when someone threatens you like that is, you don't think that I know who I am. And so it's just not a very kind way to interact with each other as a citizen legislature. I think we are not beholden to big business or big money, and it is a very different landscape for many of us who serve in the legislature. So I just wanted to mention that. Mm-hmm. Oh, there may be other things that you both wanted to say before we open it up.
And Sir McDonald, did you have something?
No. Write down the board 25 times, you won't do such and such. The attitude is, I don't care. Okay, 50 times. Threatening doesn't work.
Yeah.
200 times.
I mean, and I was going to say, I think something that we all touched on and that has come up a couple times in this conference already is just that it can feel right now that the political climate is incredibly divisive and unkind and cruel. And frankly, we're better than that, and we can be better than that. And I don't think name-calling or threatening people or behaving in a childish way is a great way to be a communicator and relationship builder, and that won't help communities for the long term. So I think keeping that in mind and just taking that moment to take a deep breath when something does get you fired up, and you should be fired up about a lot of things, but just taking that moment to say, okay, I do know that everyone in this conversation is a human and I will treat them like they are.
And strategically, you're not gonna get votes that way. You're really not. So you gotta be strategic. I saw a hand over here. So, yeah.
Well, I have a question for you. Most of what you've talked about seems to be like how we as individuals can become advocates. And I'm part of an indivisible group that moved from one town to about six towns working together. And we got the added benefit of having a national organizer in our town. And so she is helping guide us. So instead of getting together at the typical indivisible group and going, oh Christ, what do we do? And going home, you know,
depressed.
Yeah. We're actually building an organizing plan, and we met for the last time last night. And what we had done was identified all the areas that we might want to advocate in.
Mm-hmm.
And last night we voted and narrowed it down to carbon pricing.
Mm-hmm.
So as a group of several really committed and intelligent people in the Sharon Stratford area,
mm-hmm.
we're going to start an advocacy for carbon pricing. So I wondered if you had any specific advice for how groups can best
mm-hmm.
work Yeah, so sometimes when groups, so local groups can ask all their legislators or all their House and Senate members and come over to the someone's house, you know, so like your house, have all your friends there together, and then talk to them about why you organize. The fact that you're a group and you've gotten organized and that you're meeting to come up with a plan, I mean, like that's a level of, you know, commitment that often when legislators are getting calls that's not the usual thing. So I think asking for your legislators to come over and you guys have a big conversation, and then asking them asking your legislator, what can I do for you, right? Like, here there's 10 of us or a dozen, how can we support this?
My question, carbon pricing, which is an improvement in 12 months, is it's now called carbon pricing instead of carbon tax.
There's lots of improvements in our government.
Wow. This is my constituent, mm-hmm. or at least a
close
Stratford,
yeah.
If, mm-hmm. if it's a Stratford group.
Yep.
I support carbon pricing and carbon tax. If I can introduce one as a put my name on a bill, why wouldn't I put my name on a bill?
Why wouldn't you in particular? So
why would a legislator choose not to put his or her name on a bill for carbon pricing?
Because carbon pricing, as you're all familiar, is a provocative topic right now. The honest truth, this is an election year.
Right.
And Democrats and progressives were beat up heartily about the carbon tax.
What does beat up heartily mean?
That means there was a fear, and I don't think I don't actually think the fear is founded when you look at the data, but there is this fear that if people vote for a carbon tax, that they may lose their seat, right?
Right.
And so that's
fear or evidence?
The evidence is not actually spotty, and we did the data to show, and I have the data to show you, Senator McDonald, because we went through this.
Mm-hmm.
The one person who lost her seat, there's a lot of things going on in that district. Anyway, the point being is, once an issue becomes so provocative that legislators are fearful, and this is where I was saying earlier, like a lot of people believe it. The legislators believe that. And carbon and the climate change issue. They understand we have to move off of fossil fuels. They know Vermonters support it. But when they are tacked on something so simple as, hey, Senator McDonald wants to raise your gas taxes,
right?
Right? And so part of the framing has to change, which is, oh, really? Because it sounds like you are a climate denier, right? Like so the people who care about this also have to begin to frame. And that's not the job. That is not this advocacy conversation, right? That is a different conversation. But the point is, the work, you know, there's a whole electoral piece that's not this, right? That has to be more aggressive on people who don't support climate, right? And that's really Lauren's job and Amber's job. So, and one of the things that we did on when we passed the guns safety bill, which was the first guns bill that passed Vermont in like 20 years, because the Second Amendment, it was like third rail, no one can even talk about it. We were bringing people to neutral and then get them doing something easy so that they can say yes, and they understand that they're not going to lose their seat. And so it is hard to, at 30, when I realized, like, oh, actually people aren't going to vote for stuff because they may lose their seat. Like,
Which one's that?
When I was 30, like, that was when I learned, like, oh, like, I'm a little naive. I'm a little, like, there is some truth to, like, Senator McDonald, I wouldn't want you to lose your seat. You do such great work at the State House. If voting, you know, we need to do the work in the district so that you can vote, so you can support carbon pricing. And the reality is our legislature is going to follow the people.
What does work in the district mean?
So the work in the district is this work, which is that when the people who care about an issue, they talk to their legislators and they talk to their neighbors to build support for the issue so that you all are hearing about it and it makes it feel more safe.
So that should that be a part of our campaign, not only to talk to our legislatures, but talk to our
yes.
neighbors? Because,
yes.
mean, Sharon's very diverse community. It's the been-heres and the moved-heres.
Yeah.
And the been-heres are pretty adamant about the bottom line at the gas pump.
Right,
and
we have to,
so
right,
how,
right, yes.
So it's part of our job
yes.
to move them from
yes.
no to neutral. neutral.
Right, and yes, a tool, it exactly, that's exactly right. And the reality is, there is harm if all they can see is a gas tax, right?
Right.
If they don't understand, like, or they don't get an opportunity to hear about, well, it's like this new Essex plan, it's
right.
a lot, there's a lot of the things that people were afraid about, it is built into trying to solve those problems, especially around low income in the rural community. And because you're getting a electric rebate, you're actually, and some folks are actually gonna be receiving more dollars.
Mm-hmm.
So, but when the Republican Party comes out with the automatic gas tax, the fear just goes up,
right?
And so you're not able to have a conversation anymore.
So what are some of the, do you have
the
specific strategies on how to advocate in that manner for
yes.
within your community?
Yes, so Lauren, do we have on the EIV website, we have a lot of the messaging on the EIV website for these types of things.
Yeah, there was a webinar that I think it should be posted. Is it on the BNRC website now, or it's on the energyindependentvt.org website, where we did a webinar kind of walking through it, and some of that was how to talk about this. But I think, I mean, that might just flag a really focused webinar is one of the things
right.
we offer coming up of
I think that would be
let's
great, yeah.
let's keep honing in on how we can talk about it and have really productive conversations
yes.
in our community.
And almost like a kit, Lauren, so
yeah.
these groups, because I know I'm going to be going to an Indivisible group this Wednesday in my area, not specifically about this issue, but to talk about their three main issues. So as much as I can direct them and say, here is a way for you to really bump up your advocacy effectiveness.
Who are you
so,
going to? Who is it?
It's Indivisible.
What group are you going to?
What town?
What's
sorry.
The group you're going to? That's
it's
not
Indivisible Brattleboro. That's what I'm saying. They're networking with other Indivisible groups in my county. So they're trying to do this similar thing that you're doing. So I know there's a bunch of
yes.
hands jumping
so,
up.
I think what was touched on is the issue of framing and memorable phrases.
Yeah.
So some years ago there was talk about solar hot water being required, you know, in every home in Vermont. And Matt Coder at the Vermont Fuel Dealers dubbed it the cold shower tax. And you know, that
yeah.
was it.
Right.
So, and the gas tax certainly has
yes.
a lot of power. So what's the phrase that is going to do the job to support the Essex plan?
Mm-hmm.
What's the three-word phrase that will do that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, well, you mean, how? What will they do to undermine the Essex plan?
No.
No.
What, how do we fight
so
back?
We,
yeah.
What,
yeah.
So,
yes.
We have been, so
yeah.
the Essex plan is brand new, and we have been working to make it an economic issue instead of an energy issue, because what the Essex plan does is it reduces electric rates, which
right.
is good for the economy. So in some ways we've been trying to frame it from an economic perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So we are working on those things.
Could you repeat that?
So how the Essex plan was developed was with a group of business folks, legislators, and advocates, energy advocates, thinking about, well, if we were going to be able to do carbon pricing, how can we use Vermont's strengths? What is going on in Vermont which is different? You know, there are 60 carbon pricing schemes around the world, right? So this is not like it's not some new radical idea. We already have carbon taxes in our state already. So what this working group did, they said, well, what are our strengths? And what we looked at is that our electric grid is already actually almost clean, almost carbon free, right? So the idea was then how can we use everything that we're doing and create a carbon pricing scheme that fits that? And so what the Essex plan does in effect is it does put a fee, a carbon pollution fee on fossil fuels. And that is rebated on your electric bill, and it's done by sectors. So everything that is raised in the business sector goes to the business, residential, industrial, and in the residential there's these areas that address low income and the rural. But it is about reducing Vermont's electric rates, because that's one of the, you know, being in the State House for 20 years. One thing we hear from businesses all the time is the cost of electricity. So that was thought of as an economic development issue. Yes?
What is Governor Scott's position on carbon pricing?
He is not open to carbon pricing in this moment. He
has talked about, he's created a climate commission. We do think there would be likely a study that looks at it, but he is not supportive.
Now, he has acknowledged that it's carbon that's causing climate change.
He does.
Publicly acknowledged.
Right, so this is the, and I, Joey said this in the panel, which is, there is a gap between, so we, everyone knows the problem, like, and everyone knows the solution, which we can't stay on fossil fuels, right? The political will between that and actually doing something of significance about it is our that's our work, people. That's our work, right? It's gonna take, we're gonna be a few years narrowing this down so that we can actually, you know, they connect and we can get something to actually address it.
You're trying to get legislative political will.
Hmm?
You're trying to develop.
Yes,
to make legislators feel that someone has their back, or what?
Well, among other things, or that their support, or that they have the, that Vermonters care about it, and that there's a real problem, and that we have a solution that can solve it.
And I think it's maybe even bigger than that. It's really about a shift and a change in the way that we're even thinking and conceiving about problems and solutions, right? So we in Vermont.
I got to speak this afternoon then.
Yeah.
So it makes
like,
sense. When so, you say we,
yeah. And I'm
and we're
like
sitting in this
Vermont
room, who is the we?
Vermont voters and advocates. Yeah. So right now we have a situation where folks are closed down to this conversation. They're hearing the carbon tax or carbon pricing, and they're like, no, I don't even want to hear it. I don't want to have a conversation. And that's where the work of you guys comes in having those conversations with your neighbors and saying, and making sure that in those conversations, the folks that you're meeting with feel heard, they feel validated as people, but that you're pushing them too, and that you're willing to be pushed back. And that conversation over time moves and shifts, and folks start to give a little bit, they become a little more open, and that changes the way that they interact with their elected officials and changes the conversation until what today might seem an impossible ask becomes just the common sense solution that everyone's like, yeah, well, of course I support this.
So aside from the Minnesota secret weapon, which was a show, not a tell.
Sure.
What's your recommendation on how to attack? What should happen?
It's a bunch of things. I don't think it's any one silver bullet. Like, it's the conversations that you guys are having in your communities. It's the conversations that folks like Rebecca are having with legislators at the State House. It's the work of groups like the NRC and all of our partners in the Energy Independent Vermont Coalition of giving you guys the resources to even have those conversations and to reach out to your elected officials. It's providing elected officials with the most up-to-date and accurate information that we can so that they can make informed and better decisions as well. I think it's all of those pieces coming together and not just one silver bullet.
Can I ask you more about the conversations in the community? How do you do that? Do you have a talk? Do you do a door-to-door? Do you target people who have friends and then go? I mean, how do you do it?
All of those things. You can write letters to your editor in the newspaper.
Right.
And oftentimes, like, that is tied to your name, and so folks will contact you after and say, hey, I want to learn more about this.
Right.
That's a great opportunity for a conversation. If there are a lot of organizations host, like, monthly or weekly conversations, those are great ways to key in. You can say, hey, can I come present to your group about this? I want to have a conversation with you. The Rotary Club is a great example. Or any social clubs are great avenues for that.
Are your friends of friends of friends? Summer clubs,
right.
Book clubs, or
yeah.
So one thing
is kind of a challenging community because we don't have any centers or meetings. We have a church about 30 people go to, and we're no like restaurants, no.
Right.
So unless you've got a kid in school or you go to the church, there isn't any really way to interact with your community. So I'm
So maybe why don't we why don't we sit down and
thank you.
I know there's this woman in the back has had her hand up for a long time.
I was just wondering, each of you have a number of constituents, and we have skills, and in terms of an advocacy capacity, we're in a position to help with our skills.
Mm-hmm.
Who and how do we reach out and contact? For example, in my case, I'm part of the National Climate Voices as a scientist.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to figure out how to plug in at the state level. You know, I was an adjunct professor at UVM, and when the thing about you know, students being deported from campuses hit, you know, we sent all the faculty sent emails to our senators saying, how can we help? But it's too late then. We have to be pre-plugged in. We have lists of skills that we can directly plug in. The multidisciplinary, cross-disciplinary thing works really well if you're plugged in. What kind of networks exist within the state of Vermont so that, like, do I plug in with you?
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
First, and then you plug in with them. So is that a place to find the conversation so that you have us pre-positioned ready so that we need facts on this and that? Why is winter important in Vermont? I got to contact 15 scientists who could give you the knowledge, who have good communication skills so that we're getting the right lingo to start with.
Perfect. Yeah,
you know, not the biased lingo. And you need to bring us together in a pre-group quickly before the legislation goes up, before it's in the paper. The thing I found is with 34 years in climate is, you know, once the wrong group of people got the ball first, it snowballed in the wrong direction because they had their agenda they wanted to focus on rather than the large global interests.
So associations like yourself, and what are other associations other than one we have today would you advocate for us to stay involved in the process?
So we should get in touch with you first.
Definitely get in touch with me. Join our activist network.
Okay.
That would be great.
Was there and then other and then you networks? You connect to the senators. And
yeah,
such?
And so if you're interested in carbon pricing in particular, the Energy Independent Vermont Coalition is the group to connect with. That's a collection of many of us in Vermont who represent organizations working together, collecting those stories and positioning those experts to have those conversations. So that would be the place to go there.
Okay. The other thing, just really quickly, something I want to bring into the room that I think we're talking around but we're not making explicit, which is these important conversations are happening, have to happen across class and across generations. And that is a huge challenge for us in Vermont for a variety of reasons, which I won't break down, but I've seen it on the local level in just trying to activate so many of our organizations. And we're actually pretty well connected in Windham County. Many of our progressive organizations that are working on a whole host of issues have a network called the We Can Action Network. And all of those organizations feed into one listserv. Every week it goes out and it tells everything that's happening in Windham County on the issues that people care about. But what I've noticed is when I meet with people at the party, for example, at the Democratic Party around messaging, one of the breakdowns is that we have an older electorate, many of whom are not on social media. We're falling back on things that have worked in the past, like the letters to the editor, that kind of thing. But you have an entire generation of people coming up behind that don't get their news that way. And so we are basically having to do two different platforms at the same time to truly reach across communities. And it takes time, it takes energy. And so I just wanted to own that, and we also have a problem with connectivity in the state. In my county, there are plenty of towns that are not well wired, right? And so I know I'm not unique in that situation. So we're dealing with a very difficult landscape for organization. People are doing the best that they can, but we're inventing it in real time. So I just wanted to say that.
This gentleman mentioned the phrasing issue, and
yeah.
So if we want the phrase to be, maybe I just pulled out from what you said about the ethics plan, lower electric rates, if you want that to be the three-word phrase instead of gas tax,
lower
how do you get buy-in from the folks who are doing renewables? Because right now all of the incentives are, you know, it's going to lower your electric rates. So if the gas tax is going to lower your electric rates, you know, how do we shift it so that everyone in renewables can be, you know, advocating for carbon pricing along with you because they want it, you know? So that's...
Well, so the renewable community is, as someone who works with them, so they have a carbon, a climate change perspective too. Many of those folks who started their businesses, this is one of the reasons they got into it. So, the carbon pricing is one part of the solution. It is not the only one, and you're going to have renewables in any system.
Oh, absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
You're just thinking in
really
terms of the sound
bite.
Mostly
in terms of like the you know, for a lot of people, it really does come down to the financial picture. picture
yes.
when they're deciding whether to do renewables or not.
Right.
And that financial picture is based on the fact that renewables are going to lower their electric rates. So how do I talk to people about that when, you know, we're also looking at a carbon, you know, carbon pricing is also going to lower their electric rates.
Yeah, so I guess I want, so I don't.
Do you feel like the two strategies are in conflict?
So what I want to know is, are they going to be in conflict? Like, how do I discuss
it?
Laura,
I can jump in just as
come up
like,
here so that people can see.
So on that in particular, so I mean, we're working with a lot of renewable developers, and it's a great question. That's something that came up early on. I mean, the way the policy that's been put forward is structured is you could literally get a check every month if your electric bill got so low based on the rebates, your climate rebate from carbon pricing and your net metering, the whole net metering system does not change, that this is just an additional rebate. So, and the reality is if the whole premise is that we want to electrify to clean local energy, this is gonna be a boost and a spur because electricity becomes all the more if that's how we're transitioning to our energy. So it's actually should be a great thing, but figuring out how to talk about that precisely and clearly is important.
Yeah. Right, but I guess I'm also saying, so the community that you're talking about is already bought into a certain extent is what I'm saying. Right,
and I want carbon pricing, but I need to find a way to talk to my customers as a solar representative and say,
in addition to
the benefits you get from net metering, you're going to get a bigger rebate from this carbon pricing.
Now that I know that you work for the solar industry, that's helpful to understand.
Yeah.
So I didn't understand that. I thought you meant just like at door to door or something.
Okay, got it.
Okay. What are you doing? What your calling names?
All right.
Okay.
Billy, sorry.
I agree with what we're hearing and what John raised originally. I think about the phrasing discussion on. And I think it's really important to be communicating with voters along values as well as economic lines, and maybe we could be thinking about packaging the discussion as being save snowmobiling. We support carbon pricing and save ice fishing. Because
right.
And people who are involved with these sports really they're realizing seasons are shortening.
Yep.
Some years it's really bad, and it wasn't always like this. You know, a lot of people remember that. And so I don't think we're winning the discussion in the sound bites at all. You know, I think we're just getting trounced because there's so little cooperation from a lot of people are still using corporate news. They're coming in on the various networks, and you know, there are various levels of lack of cooperation between the networks, but very little in the way of support for any kind of change.
Well, I think you bring up an excellent point, Bill, because so much of this conversation around climate change, I know in my area, it comes back to fear. People are really deeply concerned on a variety of issues, but at a basic level, as Vermonters, we worry that we're not going to have a winter anymore. And what my kids ask me about that all the time. Like, is it going to snow this year? Like, are we going to ski? Are we going to do those things that we love to do? And so I think, although I'm not someone who likes to be fear-based in my messaging, I know it works to tap into that fear of losing something, fear of loss. So I actually think you're onto something really interesting here. I'm going to talk to you afterwards.
Fear of losing the maple sugar industry.
Absolutely.
The skiing industry.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, but fear closes the mind.
Mm-hmm.
It stops the process of moving forward. It actually paralyzes. So the fear approach is proven again and again to stop. If you want to stop people from working together, put the fear factor in there, and they freeze and they don't communicate and they don't cross interact.
I don't disagree, but I think what we're losing the message on is the fear around a gas tax. That they've been hammering that on us for years, and we have got to find a way to. If we're not going to work within that framework, then we better have something else that is equally as engaging. I don't disagree with
that. Right.
Yeah.
But don't do fear with fear, because then it cascades down and then the divisiveness wins every time.
So maybe it should not be about carbon pricing at all.
And
maybe what it should be about is economic development for rural Vermonters.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Supporting
working. If there were electric snowmobiles. Quiet electric snowmobiles. You would have a ton of happy people in Vermont.
I guess that's sort of changing the subject here, because personally, I've been fighting the gas pipeline for started out talking to our select board, talking to our legislators. We were all told, you know, this is a 248 process. Mm-hmm. We have to go there. And then we get to the totally entrenched in the 248 process, and they basically say, well, go to the legislature and change the laws. You know, and so I guess that's why I'm here. It's like, I feel like we've been beating our head against this wall. You say it's not political, or we're not run by corporations and large industry, but that was our experience. You know, here is this project of fossil fuel infrastructure that was basically pushed through the process, and the things that everybody was brought to know about it highlighted the fact it shouldn't have been built, yet it was. It went through, and now, you know, the whole oversight has been totally lax, and there are safety issues, and we're trying to get it out there, and we're fighting against Vermont Gas, who has this huge advertising budget, and is saying things like, yeah, this is cheap, this is good, it's clean. They're even saying it's renewable, because now they're doing this biogas thing in Salisbury, and they're at this 0.001% of the gas is going to be possibly renewable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, this is where we're at, where we want to know, how do we advocate for the truth, you know, and get people to listen, and I feel like I'm back to square one again.
Yeah.
Just to clarify, what I was saying was not that big business doesn't have an impact on the way lobbying is done. I'm saying, as individual legislators, we are not beholden because of campaign contributions. That was what I was talking about, which is not the case in many other states. So you have a situation where you actually do have a citizen legislature. That was my only point.
Okay.
I mean, so there are other issues at play here.
Is that true for all legislators? Is that true for all senators and representatives in the?
Yeah, I mean, I can't.
Nobody's?
I would say in terms of large campaign donations, I'm just looking at my own party. I'm looking at my own party.
Okay.
Yeah. So I really can't speak to across the aisle.
So I've been around a long time, and I would say a campaign contribution does not ever equal a vote of any kind. What, you know, I do think that sometimes some elected people do think of who's given them money, and they may be, maybe follow up. You know, I don't know. I just actually, I've worked for governors and for Senate presidents, and I have never had an experience where someone said, oh, well, that's my person who's contributed to me. Let me call him back faster. Like, I just haven't, that has not been my experience at the Statehouse.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I've worked a lot there. And that it is, if it's anything, it's more of who they're influenced by, their peers, legislators care about the people in their community, and that they have jobs, and that they have money to buy food. I mean, like, there is a, like, that they have their necessities, and so will they care if the major president of the big company in their town calls them? Yeah, because that company creates jobs for their people, right? But it is not like what this idea around politicians and money that is in a, it's a stereotype. That is not what.
But I also don't want to lose Jane's point, which is, how do we take back the messaging when you've got, whether it's Vermont Gas or some other juggernaut that has money, how do we effectively push back?
We have 3 minutes.
So. We have 3 minutes, okay.
Yeah. Door to door.
Yeah.
One we haven't heard from yet.
You lose that one.
I'm really glad that the conversation has shifted from advocacy to the legislature to advocacy to local groups. And sort of to follow up what you said and what the lady behind me has said, the thing that I think we're missing almost completely is that fact-based arguments do not work
mm-hmm.
against story-based emotional arguments, particularly when you have a group that is hell-bent on stopping you doing something, whatever it is. They will bring up the fear factor, and if you have not done a good job of advocacy before they get entrenched, they're already in some cases, you've lost the battle. You just might as well give it up altogether. It's just like choosing the right language for this carbon tax or good thing, but if people don't understand it on an emotional level, and you're just trying to give them facts, you'll lose.
Yeah, the social-emotional intelligence factor is much stronger in the brain than the cognitive, because it's at the base of the brain. And then the cognitive sits on top. But if the emotional level isn't set right, if the attitude isn't set right, all the cognitive in the world goes nowhere. And I'm a PhD engineer, and I've had to learn that as a fact from my social scientist colleagues, that if you want an agenda to go forward, you must see the dedication and the attitude of the people first. And then the knowledge part is easy to solve. It's the people problem that's the hard thing to solve.
And I do think that is an important part, so long as we don't lose the knowledge backup, because then we end up in a place where we see at the national conversation of alternative facts, and we don't have truth anymore, or we have disagreement about what the meaning of that truth is. And so I agree with you, and I think that part of what I was getting at earlier was that when you're having a conversation with somebody in your own community as an advocate, you know them as a person, you know details about their lives, maybe your kids go to the same school, or you guys shop at the same grocery store. You have that immediate just geolocational proximity connection with people, where you can say, I know your kid's in college, did you know the tax reform is gonna hurt college students and by taxing their stipends? How do you feel about that? Let's have a conversation. Maybe you disagree on 99.9% of every other issue that's out there, but if you can find an issue that they care about and start the conversation there and bring them along and meet them where they are, that's a pretty effective way to tap into those values that are common and shared. Without being too like, the world's gonna fall down, we're all gonna die. You know, when folks are reacting from a place of fear, you're right, like they do shut down, but the flip side of fear is opportunity and possibility, and so I'd encourage folks to think about that side of the conversation too.
I just want to say that I seem to get into conversations in my work where a lot of the people who really care about something and want to change something, that they'll come with anecdotal stories, no factual stories. And they're trying to persuade an argument using anecdotal. Oh, this is going to happen. And that's where you lose it. And it'll fade quickly if you don't come with an actual story and maybe some hard facts. At least in my era.
Yeah, I think that pairing is really important. And I think that's one thing that organizations and statewide networks do provide. VNRC, we're an outfit of folks who have an incredibly long history in the state, and we have a whole lot of technical knowledge, and you guys have the personal stories, right? And so together, we can make a pretty compelling argument for why these policies make sense for working families and Vermonters in any community.
To whom do you make the argument?
To the legislators to pass these policies. So, to you.
Yeah, but the simple one is, who in this room would disagree with banning plastic bags? I don't see any hands. Real simple law. Plastic bags are outlawed. Why isn't it passing?
That's what I'd like to know.
Because there's too many exceptions of a need that there's not a substitute right now.
Because I don't get stopped on the street and be asked why I haven't banned plastic bags.
And no one cares about it.
They did in California.
They did, but I'm so. But there's not a rally.
Oh, in Massachusetts.
Is there a banned plastic bag conference that people get up to on Saturday mornings and go to? Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but that's because it should be such a small enough issue. Can you get it through then? If it's that small,
well, who's going to get it through? Right. So anyway, let's not end here. Let's
talk. That's a microcosm of this. It's the same problem with him.
I do think that the point or the takeaway from that might be that when there is momentum and when there is community support for initiative, that's when you see action and that's when you see movement. And you guys just being here in this room, being part of your town energy committees, being willing to go out and have community conversations or host a conversation in your own home, like that is movement, that is progress, even if it doesn't always feel like it every day. But that really does make a difference, and we're moving the needle forward.
And that's just what I was talking about earlier about pre-positioning, because for example, the whole you know, gender issue, that was ready to launch for decades. And then it took Dick Cheney's daughter saying, "Daddy, you can't fight this." And it flew through. It flew through in months. And we've been holding on to that ever since. So it's a lot of it's the pre-positioning. A lot of it's having everybody ready, everybody on board, everybody quietly waiting. And then that opportunity comes, and then you launch that the bag thing can get passed in a few days. But it's the pre-positioning. It's really the pre-positioning. And that's what the offensive side does. They pre-position for a tactical, and when they see an opportunity, they go for it because that's their way of persona of thinking of it.
So obviously this is one small part of a much larger conversation, and all those people that brought up points for whom we want to engage with, please connect with Amber, please connect with us. We want to get better at the messaging. We do. We all do, and we need your help in doing that. So thanks so much for coming. Appreciate it.